And anybody who's in the vicinity and is curious, then please feel free to like mosey over or just observe from where you are. But if you'd like to get credit for attending, or if you'd like any like beverages or anything, they are available to you. The sign-in is over there if you'd like to get wings credit or points of Eagle Engage for competency and skill. Or if you just want to, help us out with attendance credit, then that would also be lovely of you. So welcome. This is our inaugural Scholar Sips lecture series for University Library. The purpose of this series is to highlight faculty scholarship and the interesting things that our faculty are doing that may be of interest to students as well. It's an opportunity to dialogue with your professors outside of the credit-bearing course structure and enjoy some drinks, some free beverages. Who doesn't like coffee? Or if you don't like coffee, there's water and golden punch. So sure enough.
Pretty water.
Yeah, absolutely. So without further ado, I'm going to introduce our speaker today, Dr. Kendra R. Parker. She is
Hi.
in the English department, and today she will be talking about Octavia E. Butler's archive. So let's all give Dr. Parker a round of applause.
Oh, thanks. Even them over there, they're studying, but I appreciate that. So I want to thank y'all for joining me, and thank you, Jessica, for the introduction and for the invitation to do this. I'm super excited. Anybody who knows me knows that I love talking about Octavia E. Butler. And so I'm going to take you all on a journey with me, walking a mile in her shoes, exploring her archives. Now, Octavia Butler did this thing called walk thoughts. So she would go walking around the San Gabriel Mountains, and she'd have a notebook, and she would just like take notes about the weather, changing leaves, poems, book ideas. And so I want you to join me on a walk as we go through some of these walk thoughts today. And at the end of the session, what I'm hoping that you'll be able to do is have answers to some of these questions, right? Who is Octavia E. Butler? Why Octavia E. Butler? For those of you who don't know what an archive is, what's an archive? How did you secure the bag? How did I get the money to go to her archives? And then what's actually in her archives? So Octavia E. Butler was born on June 22nd, 1947 in Pasadena, California, to her father, Lawrence Butler, who was a shoeshine man, and her mother, Octavia Margaret Butler, who worked as a maid in white people's houses. Her dad died when she was about 3 or 4 years old, and she actually had four brothers she never met because they also died before she was born. So she was essentially their only child. Because her mom worked as a domestic, she spent a lot of time by herself, right? She's just sitting at the kitchen table or in the back. So she was alone with her thoughts a lot of time. By the time she got to go to school, her mom would drop her off at the Pasadena Public Library. So she had her imagination, her thoughts, and books. And so she liked to read stories. When she turned 10, she watched a great movie called Devil Girl from Mars. And she hated it. She thought it was awful. And she was like, anybody can write a better story than this. And in an interview, she was like, hell, I can write a better story than this. And so she did. So she wanted to become a writer. And, even with some opposition, right, her aunt and her grandmother were like, why don't you be a nurse? Be a receptionist, not realizing that in 1957, there were no Black people receptionists anyway. And so just as impractical it was for her to be an author, it was also impractical in 1957 for her to conceive of even being like working at a desk as a receptionist. And so she was like, I'm gonna write. Even though she didn't see any Black writers at 10, she was like, I'm gonna write. Now there was one major problem with this. She was really shy. Extremely shy. And part of that shyness came because at 12 years old, she was nearly 6 feet tall. So she's bigger than most of her peers. Her voice was also deeper than her peers. She also didn't think she was very pretty because she was dark skinned. She also had a lisp and she was also dyslexic. So take all of those insecurities and wrap them up. And she was really, really self-conscious about her body, about her size, about her voice, about her lisp. But through that all, she persisted. So she was the author of 12 novels, a number of stories, essays, and she won the MacArthur Genius Grant in 1995. She was the first science fiction writer, period, Black, white, male, otherwise, to win that award. And in 2020, her book, Parable of the Sower, reached the New York Times bestseller list. That's a goal she wanted to achieve during her lifetime. She did not. She passed away in 2006 when she fell outside of her home, which was, they say, the result of a stroke. And so, despite the insecurities, despite being one of the only Black women writing science fiction at the time, she was like, I only want to be one thing. And that's a damn good storyteller. And she was, I think, clearly I'm biased. And so I got into Octavia E. Butler. It's actually a funny story. My very first encounter with her was in undergrad. I was taking this British and American class, contemporary novels, and we had to read this book right here. This is the exact copy. This is the book. And I remember looking at the cover and I was like, oh, there's some girl in it with smoke. And I flipped through it and I was like, oh, it's written in diary entry format. And I was like, I don't want to read it. So I didn't. So if your professors are like, you should always read for class, just know this one didn't always read for class. So just saying, I didn't always read for class. I'm not saying to do that. I'm just saying I can't be hypocritical and pretend like I didn't not read for my classes sometimes. So fast forward to graduate school. I was at Howard University and Dr. Gregory Hampton had just published this book, the first single author book on Octavia Butler. And he was like, hey, dig it. You gotta take this class on Butler. It's going to be hot. And I was like, okay, I don't even know who she is. And so the first day of class, like he was listing the book she's read. And I was like, wait a second. I feel like I've heard this name before. So I go back to my dorm room and I pick that book up. And I was like, oh, I didn't read this. Well, we didn't read that book. And we didn't read that book in her class, in that class anyway. And I honestly didn't read that book for the first time until 2014. So it took me, not quite a decade, but a decade to actually read that book. And I love that book. That's the funny part. I love teaching it. My students are always like, why didn't you like that book? Don't ask. I was senioritis. That's what I'll blame it on. But I took his class and absolutely fell in love with her work. And my seminar paper for that class was tracing the trope of vampirism in her fiction. And that became my dissertation. And then that became my book, She Bites Back, which was published in 2018. And so there are two chapters in that book that focus on Butler. And right around the time I was finishing this book, Dr. Hampton reached out to me. He was like, hey, we need a Butler companion. Let's do an edited collection on Octavia E. Butler together. Okay. So we solicited, you know, chapters from scholars. We got this together. And in November 2019, we just finalized the cover. We'd just been talking to the editor. And I got an email from his wife that he passed away in his sleep. And so the book was completed in November 2019. He never actually saw it published when it released in March of 2020. So September 2020, I had an email from Linda Wagner Martin at the University of South Carolina Press. And she was like, would you be interested in writing a book proposal for a book called Understanding Octavia E. Butler? It would be part of our Understanding American Literature series. And we've got titles like Understanding James Baldwin, Understanding Toni Morrison, Understanding Colson Whitehead. And you know, I ignored her for a couple of days because I didn't think that I was the person to be writing it, right? I was like, Dr. Hampton should be writing this. Dr. Hampton would have been like, no. You write this. I'm a full professor. This is your thing. And I did. So I got a book contract. And I figured, I was like, well, if I'm going to write this book called Understanding Octavia E. Butler, you know, I know her. I've read her works. I've taught her stuff. But I need to go to her archives. Now, what's interesting is that her archives didn't become available to the public until 2016. So I didn't really have that opportunity for my book project. Dr. Hampton and I didn't have the opportunity to go, although one person in that collection did. It was still very new. And so I said, well, if I'm going to go write this book called Understanding Octavia E. Butler, I got to go to the archives. So if you don't know what an archive is, though most of you here might, essentially it's a collection of historical documents, right? Cool. And you like archive materials, and then you go to the archive, the place. But when we think about archives, it's also important to think about what it means to be Black while going to the archives. So this historian named John Hope Franklin often talks about his experience going to the archives, where he walks up, he tries to sign in, and they're like, why are you here? Because they didn't think that Black people would be even interested in archives. And then he told them why he was there. He was like, I'm here to look at the slave records. And he was like, why? Who cares about enslaved Black people and what they were doing? And so this idea that Black people have no place in the archives as intellectuals, or that their lives aren't worth living or understanding, was something that he experienced and a number of Black scholars experienced. In the archives at the Huntington Library when I went, it was also very interesting to see the structure. There are busts of dead white men that just circle the room, which is fine. It was a welcoming place, but it was also really interesting to see what it means to be in the archive. Related to that, the collection of historical documents has a particular connotation. Which historical documents are relevant? Letters, the Declaration of Independence, slave ledgers in terms of like how many people were sold, but maybe not obituaries. And Black people, we keep obituaries, and they tell you a lot of historical records. And so trying to reconcile what's a relevant archival document and what's not a relevant archival document is something to keep in mind. And Butler kept everything. She was her own archivist. She kept letters, correspondence, book manuscripts that she was writing, but she also kept like play tickets, receipts, maps with just highlights on them, bills, and her notations, because she was always concerned about money. She kept budgets, just a list of budgets. She kept everything. So I knew that I wanted to go to her archives. And Butler always said for her that writing is a way to get money. And I knew that if I'm flying to Pasadena, California, I need to secure that bag. I need to get me some money. And so this process was really interesting because I applied for 3 external grants for a total of about 5,000 words for about $14,000. So that's what I applied for. I got 2, one internal, one external, for about $8,500, which is fantastic because it funded my entire trip. But it wasn't just about me, right? This is a collaborative process. Writing is a way to get money, is what Butler would say. But also taking classes and understanding what you're writing about is also important for getting money. I ended up taking grant writing workshops. I've written books. Y'all saw them on the screen. Just saying. But grant writing is a different beast. So I know how to write, but grant writing is different. So I took 2 workshops, one with Dr. Beauty Bragg at the NEH and one with Dr. Shauna V. Benjamin. They were virtual. I wanted to put myself in the best position possible to go ahead and get that money. But it wasn't just about me taking classes. Getting this money is also a collaborative process. People had to vouch for me. They had to write letters of recommendation for me. And so without Dr. Dana A. Williams and Dr. Tarsha Stanley's letter of recommendation, I wouldn't have gotten the money because they have to put their reputation on the line. They have to vouch for who I am. And that's no easy task because you don't want to just vouch for everybody. They know I'm good for it. But then also Dr. J.T. Hughes and Dr. Laura Ragasa here at Georgia Southern, you know, I got the Scholarly Pursuit Grant as well. I had to navigate budgets, navigating some red tape while applying for the external grants, and they were really helpful in doing that process. And then, of course, here in the library, I know y'all were sick of me coming in here summer 2020. I promise I was in here every day, and the person at the front desk was like, I have your books. I was like, dang, you know me on sight. I was like, all right, thank you. And so that's how I got the money, right? It was a collaborative process. I had to take classes, something that Butler really believed in. You had to have a community, something Butler struggled to have, but wanted. People have to vouch for you. And I had to do the work to get the money to go. And I did. So what does it look like for a day in the archives at the Huntington Library in San Marino, California? I would get up from my hotel, walk about a mile to the bus stop, take the Pasadena Bus 10, through Pasadena. I'd pass Pasadena City College where Butler went to school. I'd get off at the bus stop and walk about 7/10 of a mile to the entrance of the gardens, because it's the Huntington Library Gardens and Art Museum. And then from there, I'd walk another half a mile into into the archives. I'd wave my little security badge at security, and then I'd end up at the Munger Research Center, and then they'd scan my badge and I'd go in. So that badge is important. If I don't scan it, I don't get paid. I need that money. I did all this work for this money. I'm going to get this money. So I needed the money to get in. And from 9 to 4, the archives were open. In a couple of days, it was 9 to 7. And you sit, you go to, you find your desk, you sit up, you go to circulation, scan again. And they say, what box do you want? You take the box and you sit down and you read. And that is what you do in the archives, day in, day out. And it seems kind of boring and it seems kind of tedious, but it was quite a bit of fun. And so my process through the archives, I had 4 things that I was really interested in. Now, the archives are in person, but because of COVID, they started virtual archives. So in September 2022, I actually started looking at the virtual archives. And one chapter of my book on understanding Octavia Butler is Butler as a genre writer. And I was interested in her as a romance writer in particular. So when I started with the virtual archives, I was like, you know what? I'm looking for stuff about romance. And I found some things. I found a lot of things. And then as I was doing that, I did that from September to June 2023. I'm going through, and she wants to be a life writer. And so in about September, that's when I decided to apply for these grants. And I was like, I want to look at Butler as a life writer, right? She's a genre writer in terms of romance. She's also an autobiographer. But when I got to the archives in person, I realized she didn't actually want to write the memoir. She didn't want to write the autobiography. She would start and stop. There was very little in the material that I found. And so then I had to start thinking about the relevance of what I was doing and the ethics, not because like, is it relevant and is it ethical to tell you the name of the first person she slept with? You can go to the archives. You can find that out. Like, that's not relevant. And I don't think that is ethical. She didn't want to bare herself to different people, the work that it takes to write an autobiography, to reveal certain things about herself. She was intensely shy and private. But I think it was useful to look and see, you know, her ideas about community. And the thing that I found as I was reading, going through, she struggled with her body image. And I thought this was relevant to me, not for the book project, but for my next project, which I'm interested in looking at the depictions of fat Black women in African American literature. That's one of the things I'm interested in. So she had really negative self body image. We would say that she suffered from an eating disorder. She often engaged in restrictive eating. She would compare losing weight to a broken bone healing. And she was like, it takes 6 weeks for a jawbone to heal. So I can lose, I think it was like 15 to 20 pounds in 6 weeks. That's a lot. And then she went on to list the only things that she was going to eat. And so that's actually not surprising, because her writing, her desire for companionship, and her body image were tied up together. And because she couldn't control her body image, she couldn't control her romantic partnerships, she did think she could control her writing. And when she suffered from writer's block, she was unable to control any of that. She would fall into an intense depression, right? She was always writing. She just wasn't writing anything worthwhile. And so this is the process that I went through over the course from September 2022 to the end of July of this year. But to break it down a little bit further, I want you to know, like, how much time I spent. I spent 130 hours in the archive. 30 of those hours were virtual. They were 3 sessions a month, 1 hour per session for 10 months. I spent 100 of those hours in person. So I did about 5 hours a day, Monday through Friday. There are 398 boxes in Octavia E. Butler's archive. Just laughing. In that, she kept everything. In those boxes together, there's about 8,000 items in those boxes. So that's about, I think, if we're just calculating a part, like, it's like 20 to 25 items per box. I was able to get through 34 boxes. It's less than 1%. I reviewed less than 1% of her stuff in the 130 hours in the year that I did it. Now, y'all are probably like, well, you ain't get through nothing. I did. I was very strategic, because the curator, Carla Nielsen, did a really good job curating. And so things were labeled. So there were things labeled like memoir. So I was able to go right to those. I wasn't interested in Butler's manuscripts, like the drafts of novels. I wasn't interested in those because it's not relevant to my book project. So I was really able to curate what I wanted. Did I get to everything? No. But I just want to emphasize the sheer volume of her stuff. 398 boxes, 8,000 items. I spent 130 hours and I still only reviewed less than 1% of her stuff. So people spend, I mean, I applied for a short-term fellowship intentionally, but you can apply for a year-long fellowship. And I'm still not convinced that with a year-long fellowship that you'll get through all of it. Maybe you could, I don't know. But so that's what I did. But that's the physical archive, the in-person archive, the print archive. But I also knew that when I took this trip that I wanted to do a little bit more. I didn't just want to go sit in the library all day and read her stuff. I really wanted to live like Octavia Butler did. She did not drive because she was dyslexic. She didn't have a driver's license. So she took public transportation. That was cool for me. I lived in Washington, D.C. for 5 years. I'm excited about this. But I was trying to figure out a way to conceptualize it, because when I talked to people, I was like, I'm going to the archives and then I'm going to like travel around and look at different things, until I came across Tamara Rhodes's piece. She's a librarian. And she was talking about the living archive. And she was talking about it for her particular library, what a living archive was. And she said, a living archive can be something like digitization, right? Or people sharing their memories, their stories. And I was like, you know what? I'm going to experience Butler's living archive by sharing the memories and spaces and places that she inhabited. And I did that by going to Pasadena, Los Angeles, and Altadena, California. So I knew the one place that I was going, if I didn't go anywhere else, was the LA Central Library, Los Angeles Central Library. This place is gorgeous. It has 8 levels. Not 1, not 2, not 3, not 4, not 5, not 6, not 7. 8 levels. The tour, I took an art and architecture tour. The docent was Tom McQuaidie. It started at 11. I got there at 9:30 because I was making sure I got there on time. And I got into this atrium here and I just turned around, because I don't even know what floor this was. It's the main level and you drop down. So it was gorgeous. The tour was supposed to be an hour. It was like 2 hours in. He was like, I'm so sorry, I kept y'all too long. Mm-mm. We're fine. But the reason I wanted to go to this library is because Butler loved this library. She wrote books here. She was really fond of this library. This library actually burned, not down, but it caught on fire in 1986. And she wrote about it. And she described it as the death of a friend. She said, "I don't know how I will write this. This isn't the first time I've seen a friend, a loved friend, die." In fact, she saw a friend die from cancer in 1982. But she said, "But it is the first time I've seen one killed." She was really grief-stricken at this. She got on the bus. She's on her way to the library. She tells the bus driver she's on the way to the library. And he was like, "No, you're not. It's on fire." And you can see smoke coming out of the window. She talks about that. It was arson. Don't think they ever found the arsonist. The interior was damaged. Some materials and things were lost, but she was really devastated because she believed that libraries were a public good, number one. She also was raised by libraries. She called libraries her second home. She even wanted to write a history of this library because of the architecture and all of those things. And so she was devastated. And she actually went back to this library in 1993, which is the same year she published "Are Libraries Extinct?" an op-ed calling readers to action to be like, "Hey, don't defund the library." So she would actually be really horrified by what's happening right now with public libraries in general. So on the way back, the very next day, this is July 23rd on a Sunday, I'm on the way back that Saturday when I'm at the library. I'm on the metro and I was like looking for something to do. And they said, "Oh, hidden gems in Pasadena." And there's this place called Eaton Canyon. And I was like, "Oh, cool. Butler liked to hike." And my cousin, Jennifer, she'd come the weekend before and we were going to hike to the Hollywood sign and we didn't. And so I was like, "Man, I didn't get to hike. Well, let me go hike this. I know Butler, she liked to hike. She liked the San Gabriel Mountains. She would look up at them and call them my mountains." And she said she was really intimidated. She hiked the Grand Canyon and she said, "Ooh, those people felt bad for this old woman." She's like, "I made it down fine, but like walking back up, it was a struggle." She's like, "They were handing me water," but she said she did it. So I hiked to Eaton Canyon and it was really nice. Like I was in the San Gabriel Mountains that she walked around and that she saw all the time and sort of talked about. And, you know, I sent pictures to my friends and everybody was like, "Did you get in? Did you get in?" I was like, "No, I didn't get in. I didn't know I was going. It was the last minute. I just found out about it." So they were like, "Oh, okay, well, maybe next time." So the next day on Monday, while I'm in the Amundsen Reading Room in the Munger Research Center, I get box number one and it's the pictures and correspondence. And there's this picture of Octavia Butler in a pink shirt in the Central Library, right where I was standing. And I was like, "Oh, shoot." I knew she went there and I knew she liked it, but it was sort of weird to be like, on Saturday, I was standing right there on the opposite side where she took this picture. So I'm going through the pictures and I'm going through her cards. And this one, she's talking to her friend, Frances, and she was like, "It was fun sharing the rain and Eaton Canyon with you." I was like, "I didn't know that. I didn't know that." Like, I knew she hiked the Grand Canyon. I knew she liked to hike. It sort of makes sense. I remember texting a friend of mine and he was like, "I feel like I read that somewhere." I was like, "It's possible I did." But Eaton Canyon didn't ring a bell, none of that. So between that and between my friends being like, "You have to go back," I did. I went back to Eaton Canyon the very next Sunday with another Butler fellow. And because I'm an overachiever, I not only got in the water, this last picture over here, I actually climbed up side of the mountain to get a better view. I didn't jump in, I walked through, right? But I really wanted, once I realized that she was there, I wanted to go back with the knowledge, knowing that she was there. It's different just, you know, hiking for hiking's sake, but this was part of the living archive. I realized I was sharing memories with her. That is really what I wanted to do. So part of this living archive was me returning to the place with a newfound knowledge that she was actually there, now sort of sharing space and time with her. Sort of nerdy, but I wanted to find Washington Boulevard. So one of her short stories called Speech Sounds that she won an award for, the first line is called "There Was Trouble Aboard the Washington Boulevard Bus." Okay. But she actually was on the Washington Boulevard bus when a fight broke out. So she took her real life and would put it into her stories. So I'm going to one of her libraries and I'm mapping out the bus route and it says north on Fair Oaks. And I would get off at Fair Oaks in Washington. And I was like, is it that same Washington Boulevard? And it was. So I took a picture of Washington Boulevard. I was on the Washington Boulevard bus, number one. And then I took a picture of the Washington Boulevard sign because I'm a nerd. And I was like, "Ha ha, I'm there," like in the story on the bus that she was on. Super excited. The library that I went to on Fair Oaks in Washington was La Pinterosca Branch Library. This is a library that she went to when she was a little girl. She would walk down the street from her school. This is where she would sit in what she called the Peter Pan room, which they had like age restrictions on what you could read. And she was really frustrated because she was like, I'm tired of reading about horses. I want to read something more advanced. But she was, you know, relegated to the Peter Pan room for a while. So I wanted to go see the library, but not just to see the architecture in the library. I also wanted to participate in the community that Butler really, really wanted, because she didn't want just her books to be in the ivory tower. She wanted people in the community to read. There was a book club having Butler book readings all summer long. I met once a month. And so Saturday at the La Pinturosca Branch Library, shout out to Anne Marie Kolakowski for this picture at the bottom. We had a book club discussion, and guess what book it was? Parable of the Sower. So I was so excited, and so I went, and it was great to be among people, some who didn't know who she was, right? They lived in Pasadena their whole lives, didn't know who she was. It was their first encounter with her, unless they went to the previous meeting, and they loved her work. Different people from all walks of life. It was really a great experience. So for me, it wasn't just about going to see the place and be like, oh, there's a pretty picture. It was about immersing myself in the community that she lived in and worked in. And then I also visited her grave in Altadena. I took the 60 bus, went to the Mountain View Cemetery. And of course, you know, it's Mountain View. So she's literally looking over the San Gabriel Mountains are looking over her. And what's great about it is I walked inside because I knew where her grave was in terms of the grave marker, but it's huge. You got to find it. And I was on foot. So I walked in, I met this guy named Daniel, and I was like, can you help me, like, point me in the right direction of the grave? And he was like, who are you looking for? And I said, Octavia Butler. And he was like, the writer? I said, yeah. He said, get in. I'll drive you to her grave. Because enough people were there. So instead of me, I mean, I did walk back. But he drove me there and left me, and I got to see her grave, to see her final resting place, which was really nice, especially since, you know, like I said, Dr. Hampton passed away. It was sort of a nice moment for me because his favorite book was Parable of the Sower. And the quote on her grave is, all that you touch, you change, all that you change, changes you. And that was the refrain at Dr. Hampton's memorial service as well, all that you touch, you change. And so it was a really lovely moment for me. I did not find her mom's grave. Her mom's grave is there as well. Didn't find it, but I did find her aunt's grave. So I thought that was actually really cool too. But I didn't just want to think about the places that she'd been, the places that she'd been while she was alive. In 1993, she wrote this, that she was thinking about her legacy, about the things I hope to leave when I die. She said ideas. She knew that her ideas would last. And her ideas did last, and people took those ideas and they sort of ran with them. So I knew I wanted to go to Washington STEAM Multilingual Academy. Not because it's the school where she went, but because it was renamed after her. Just this year, in February, Octavia E. Butler Magnet. A legacy she left. She was a proponent of public education. She really was sad about some of the literacy rates in the United States. She was really sad that we funded prisons more than we funded libraries and schools. And so it's fitting that they renamed the school from Washington to Octavia E. Butler Magnet. But I also visited Octavia's Bookshelf, which is the first Black-owned bookstore in Pasadena, California. It opened in February of this year. The owner, Nikki High, in the black tank top, was really gracious. But I went twice. The first time I went, I was by myself, and I got the Octavia's Bookshelf bag and stickers. And the second time, the soon-to-be Dr. Ebony Gibson, standing next to me, was like, hey, I've contacted the bookstore owner, and she wants to, meet with us. And I was like, no, I've already been. I was like, it's fine. And she's like, if you change your mind, let me know. And then I was like, when are you going to be back in Pasadena? When are you going to meet the bookstore owner of Octavia's Bookshelf, somebody who loves Butler just as much as you do? I texted Ebony back. I was like, I'll be there. I will meet y'all there. And we had a great time. And it was really something because she grew up in Pasadena too. She wanted more people to know who she was. Pasadena is known for Jack and Mackie Robinson. It's known for the Rose Bowl. And she was like, I want it to be known for Octavia Butler as well. And we had a fantastic time just talking. I mean, she didn't close the store down, but, you know, people were walking in, buying stuff, and we're just sitting there having a conversation. And they just moved right next door to a bigger space. And so she's really happy about that growth. She hasn't even been there for a year. So a legacy, right? Octavia's Bookshelf, something Butler never really dreamed of. She just thought she'd leave ideas, and she's leaving schools, bookstores, and innovative labs. So at the LA Central Library, there's this thing called Octavia's Lab because she was a science fiction writer, right? She wrote 12 novels, a number of short stories. She was always thinking about innovation. She was always thinking about the future. In homage to her, the LA Central Library created the Octavia's Lab, where people can come and learn to create, whether it's podcasting, Adobe Workshop, anything you can think of, you can come to Octavia's Lab to innovate and to create, to be visionary forward thinkers in the same way that Butler was. And so this entire experience was really, really transformative for me. I feel like I know Butler, like I knew who she was, right? I'd read her books, I taught her works all the time, but there was something really important about walking a mile in her shoes, right? Getting to share time and space with her. So I knew her for sure, but I feel like I didn't meet her, really meet her until I spent some time walking through her archives, static and living, taking a mile in her shoes. Thank you. Questions, I think. You can walk through. Hi. Oh, Scholar Sibs talking about Octavia E. Butler. Several. Yeah, I walked about on average every day. It would be like 5 miles a day. Yes. Ooh, the one I'm reading at the time. She's like, okay, thank you. I like that. But the question, yes, repeat the question. So the question was, what's my favorite book of Octavia Butler's? And I cheekily responded, the one I'm reading at the time. I mean, I do think that's an honest answer, though. It's really hard to answer what's my favorite. Now, I heard you say earlier that you aren't really, you've never really read science fiction.
I've just read, like, Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy.
Okay.
It's not at all, like, similar, I feel like.
Okay. So if you've never really read science fiction or something like this, I always recommend Kendra, right? It's a really great place to start. My mom has read it. My sister recently read it, and she texted me. She was like, Kindred. And I said, oh, you're starting it. She's like, no, I finished. I started last night and I finished this morning at 4 a.m. Oh, it's the same. So Kindred, I think one that's understudied or underappreciated is Wild Seed. Love Wild Seed. If you like vampire novels, I recommend Fledgling. If you want to be sort of terrified about the current state of things, read Parable of the Sower and its sequel, Parable of the Talents, because, you know, there's a global pandemic. Housing crisis, water crisis, a presidential candidate who says make America great again as a presidential slogan, religious fundamentalism. So she said she was not a psychic, that she was offering a cautionary tale. And people were like, this is very prophetic. She was like, oh, God, I hope not. And so she wrote those two books in 1993 and in 1998, and she passed away in 2006. And so... but if you're sort of new to Butler, most people start with Fledgling. I actually recommend Dawn too. I know my thesis student Megan Bowen, I think, is on the chat. Loves Dawn. Dawn is a great book. If you like aliens, start with Dawn. It'll freak you out. But you're like, I'm not sure if that was helpful or not. But you have options. Megan loves Dawn.
Favorite place to visit.
Ooh, my favorite place to visit.
Libraries, because I feel like you had a lot of energy there.
Yes, I did love LA Central. I'd probably say Eaton Canyon, right? It was nice. It wasn't it wasn't isolated. That was I just thought people on a Sunday, there's going to be nobody hiking. And the first day I go, I walk into the little building and I was like, excuse me, can you point me in the direction of the waterfall? And he was like, just follow the crowd. That's where everybody's going. And I was like, what crowd? And then I was like, oh, so it wasn't like a mass exodus of people, but there were enough people. And, you know, so I liked that. I do think, though, that going to the public library, the Pintoresca Branch Library, was also probably my favorite event, right? Seeing people from all walks of life just sort of talk about Butler, and me not being, you know, I wasn't there as a scholar. It was not the, hey, you, I was sitting there just like listening, like, yeah, like, oh, there was, I think, a girl, she couldn't have been more than like 12 or 13, like dropping knowledge. We was like, the kids are smart. So that was probably my favorite event that was Butler related. I will say the Huntington Gardens are gorgeous. You can get lost. They will have a truck come by every half an hour if you're lost to come pick you up. There's a museum. They have a small exhibit dedicated to Butler. The larger one was taken out. I will say going to the, I mean, this wasn't part of her archive that I was talking about, but, you know, going to see the Hollywood Walk of Fame was actually a lot of fun. I know it's real touristy, but it was nice to see, like, the Boys to Men star. I don't know. So, yeah.
It was really interesting to me. It's not really a question, but a comment about how you wanted to go back to Eaton after you had read from the archives. Mm-hmm. And that combination of the intimacy of the archives but the real lived experience is really interesting. I mean, that could be an interesting essay.
Thank you. So for you on Zoom, the comment was, she was saying that it was really cool how I decided to go back to Eaton Canyon after having gone back to the physical archive itself, saying there's this sort of intimacy between the dynamic, the living archive, and the static one. And yeah, it was really, I was like, I have to go back at this point. Like, people were sending me, they're like, well, here's a waterproof case, you know, like, here's a link to it. I bought it. Let me, and I had it Amazoned to my hotel room. Mm-hmm. So yeah, thank you. Did you have a question? Yes. Ooh, so for anyone interested in doing archival work at the Huntington, yeah, in general, I'd recommend going to the circulation desk at your library. Like, that's the best place to start. But also, if not there, like, click on the library's website to see if they have archives. I also went to virtually, I found out that the Schomburg Library in New York had some archival material on Butler. And so I was able to request it digitally and they gave me a PDF of it. Now at the Huntington Library, they have a bunch of stuff. I know about Butler because that was my only interest, but the Huntington Archives rivals only the Library of Congress in terms of material. So the Library of Congress has the most, and it's my understanding that the Huntington Library is second underneath that, which is a big deal. So I would, yeah, it's huge. I would start by going to the Huntington's website. You'd have to first sign up as a reader, which everybody can apply to be a reader. And if you're a reader, you can access the archives. I would also recommend going to their sort of index of what's in the archive, because you can request a virtual session. You'd have to go to, like, become a reader, apply as a reader online, you get a virtual reader card. When you go in person, you get the physical one. And then you sort of, you know, go, I'd look at the list of things you want to do, and you request a box, and then you can have a virtual session and sit down for an hour. And the person I worked with was Nathaniel DeGala, and we would sit, he would have the dot camera, and he'd say, this is box 357, item 1,402. And then he'd flip the page and I'd read and I'd be like, okay, next page. It's a funny story about that. I'd only seen his hands for 10 months. So the first day that I got there, there were two people talking, Jasmine and some other person. And I was like, excuse me, I do have a question. Is Nathaniel DeGala here? And he was like, I was like, oh my God, it's you. I've only seen your hands. And so they were laughing because, you know, I and not even just mostly his fingertips. So, I mean, not even, because not even, I was like, is he here? And he was right there. He's like, these are my hands. So recognize his voice after he spoke, but. So that's essentially the process, but like, I'd start at the library in person and see, like, do you have archives?
Yeah.
Mm. Nothing. No. Rest. Hopefully, August 31st, I actually submitted the book. I submitted it to the publisher. Thank you. Yeah. So. Hopefully a little bit of rest. It was at 79,000 words. So once I get back from peer reviewers, I've got to cut about 9,000 words. But I was just like, look, 6,000 of those words are references. So can you cut me a little slack? I was like, they're like bibliography. So, but right now, what am I working on? I am working on something. Just give me, I'm working on Black vampires. I'm going to do a piece on the Vampire Diaries. The entire series, it's going to be called The Final Black. the final Black throughout the Vampire Diaries series. But in terms of Butler for now, there's nothing until I finish this particular book project. Like I said, the interesting thing that I found about her her body image and her weight issues is, you know, there are no fat characters in her work, which is okay, cool. So that's what my interesting project is going to be, looking at fatness in African-American literature. But I did find that in an unpublished manuscript draft of a book called Blind Sight, there is a character who thinks she's fat. And her boyfriend, who's blind, is like, no, you just got curves. I don't care what you look like. And so she was different from her other peers. So I would like to go back and revisit some of that. And so in spring 2026, I'm supposed to be teaching a grad course on that. And so what I would like to do is look at life writing. So Roxane Gay, KSA Lehman, and if possible, I could have as an assignment for my grad students to access the Butler archives to see what she says about her body image and sort of weave the conversation in that way. And I just found that out yesterday. So that's why it's a little unformed in my mind. But for now, nothing is happening until I get that stuff back from the peer reviewers, and then, you know, finish that and then go on to the next task. Yes. Oh, and sorry, the question was, what is next for you and Octavia Butler? My bad. Other comments or questions? Any on Zoom?
Would you recommend to introduce someone who's new?
Okay. Probably someone who's new. Probably Kindred or Dawn. They're two very different books, but I think both of them will sort of grab your attention in different ways.
Mm-hmm. And then I guess the final question is, should we be writing everything down in our lives and saving everything in case it's important?
I don't know if social media has taught us anything. Maybe we shouldn't, because like a lot of this stuff is just, you'd be like, you should have wrote that in a diary, as opposed to publicly posting it. But diaries have transitioned, right? Sort of the archiving materials are digital now. I think the difficulty with doing archival work, especially with something like journals, is that people are going to read it and it may color their perceptions of you as a person. And she would also write her stuff in Spanish. So that was, part of the tedious nature of going through her work, is that it was a lot of it was handwritten. A lot of it was written in pencil. And then sometimes she would translate it into Spanish. So if her mom or grandmother found the journal, they couldn't read it. And so I'm sitting there going from English to Spanish to translating. So she didn't want this stuff read anyway, but she did donate her materials to the Huntington Library. So like she wanted them to be there. That was one of her requests upon her death, was that they get her material. So this is sort of weird negotiation. So I don't know. I write in my journal, and then every couple of years I shred the material. So yeah, y'all can have my books and stuff after I die, but I don't think I want y'all to have like private innermost thoughts. Yeah, you have to decide, because if it's there.
It's striking how you show how intimate it is.
Mm-hmm.
And it is intimate, because you are reading it. It's much different than reading her as a published author.
Mm-hmm.
This is, her notes on her budget.
Her notes on being a horrible writer, her notes on being ugly, her notes on, some of the fascinating things were like, she was like, I need a man, but he has to have a legal profession. But I also don't want him around all of the time. She was like, because I need my space. But she was like, we need pleasurable company and this, that, and the third. And you're just like.
But that's identifiable.
Mm-hmm, it is. It is. And one of the things I will say, you didn't see a lot of pictures from the archive up here. That's because we're not allowed to show them without permission. I've got pictures on my phone, but I can't necessarily publicly show them or publish them in the same way. So there's a picture of the box. I can show you the box, because it's not her words. Now you will find stuff online where people have gone to the archives and published it, but sometimes they will say, I don't know if it's called a cease and desist, but they will ask you to take that stuff down sometimes.
The archives does that, but they were
not the archives, Butler's estate. So if I want to publish even some of the quoted material, I have to get permission from the estate to do that. Mm-hmm. The estate is run by Marilee Heifetz. That's the person who was her agent at one point, and so she bequeathed that to her. Yeah, no, she doesn't have children. Mm-hmm. Like a friend. Mm-hmm.
So, is the library that either one of us attended, did they keep her, pickup records or anything? Because I know sometimes that's private.
The question was, did the libraries keep her checkout records? That I don't know. I could, I know at the La Pintoresca Library, they have books that she signed. They have her yearbook, which was at the Pasadena Historical Society. So they have the yearbook. I don't know. I could ask, I would have to email and ask Anne Marie, the librarian I met there, to see that. And she also did some research for me because we were trying to find out the name of one of the teachers she had a crush on. because it was written in Spanish, Mr. Acosano, and so she was like, no, she was trans, and we couldn't find it. So,
I say, beginning of the librarian, A, probably not, and B, I kind of hope not, is generally that. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah, that's why I was curious about, interested, but because I figured, she's attended so much, she probably had lots of chats with the librarian, just casual conversation.
Chats with librarian. She would also. Do you know what a call number is?
Yeah.
Okay. She would write down the call number, and so she would go to the library and pull that information. So she'd do call numbers.
Some call numbers in her archive.
Mm-hmm. Just she'd handwrite them. She did a lot of books on tape. So she would listen to books. She would recommend books to people.
Intimate details about her life.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I could tell you what the brand of hair dye she did. I can tell you what shoes she bought at Sears every year. The same pair of shoes. Reeboks, black Reeboks. One was indoor pair, outdoor pair. She did, she called it Lady Clairol hair dye. She used Noxzema skincare products. I saw a receipt at Rustin's Tall Girl store. It was sort of faded out, but I was like, oh, what'd you get there? She kept grocery store receipts. I think the coolest thing was I think I took a picture of it. And it was it was a grocery store and she had a lot of food for $5. It was 68 cents here. And I was like, oh, wow, that would not be $5 right now.
That's before inflation.
Yeah. So obviously, kind of a fan or something of her work.
Just a little. Just a little.
And obviously, where's the archive? Is there any other books that you're... The way you appreciate them or what you think about them has just changed in terms of the archives? You learn something and it sort of shifted how you think about it entirely?
Yeah, so the question is there anything in her archives that made me shift how I thought about one of her novels? I would say it'd be Kindred. I knew that she went on a research trip to Maryland, so she sold one of her novels in advance. She didn't think it was finished, but she was trying to fund her research trip to Maryland because Kindred is about a Black woman who time travels back into slavery. And her notes on the research that she did, she was at Mount Vernon, the notes that she took to sort of research that, but also she took the Greyhound bus cross country. And so her notes on the landscape, the shifting landscape, not just in terms of geography, but she would say things 10 years ago, I wouldn't have been able to sit here. 10 years ago, there wouldn't have been a bus driver here. And so she was literally going back in time in her thoughts while going forward, seeing what was happening. And I was like, wow, so you were literally having this moment. It's no wonder you sent Dana back in time, who was going forward but backwards at the same time. But also the notes of the things that she saw at Mount Vernon, she would describe the shackles. You've seen pictures, but to see her describe them was really weird. Not weird, but unsettling is a better word. But I think that gave me a deeper appreciation for the work that she did with Kindred, to really get people to feel slavery. That's it? Okay. Thanks, y'all. That was fun. Thank you
for being our inaugural speaker.
Thank you.
Just a reminder to folks, if you're on Zoom and you want Wings or Eagle Engage credit for attending, then just put in the chat your email address and your Eagle ID, and I can get you recorded. Same thing for folks who have been lingering around and just listening.
They're like, hey.
well, if you would like. And finally, we've got a lot of coffee and a lot of beverages, so please take them. They are free. free coffee. I'll repeat it again for everybody. This never happens in the library. So thank you all once again.
Oh, that's good. I did. No, not at all.
Tony has
asked,
what drove Ms. Butler to write the work that she did?
Oh, what drove her? So she was, that's, no, 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 that's actually, that's my sister.
All right.
As soon as you said it, I was like, yeah, that's my sister. So she didn't see herself in books that she read. So that was one of the things, but she was also, and that was as a Black person, but also as a woman. One of the things she says is that, you know, she would read books about horses and women who wanted to learn how to ride a horse. But by the end of the novel, instead of aspiring to like own the horse ranch, they just wanted to marry a rancher so they could have access to a horse. And she was like, she was reading about vapid women, and there were no Black people. She said the science fiction books she was reading were like white men going to conquer other lands. And she was like, I didn't see myself. And so she, I think one, a direct quote is, I didn't see myself, so I wrote myself in because I'm here and I'm me. And if nobody's going to do it, I'm going to do it myself. So she was, for somebody who was really shy, I mean, she was very self-aware. And she, I don't know, you wouldn't think she was shy just based on the things that she wrote and the quotes that she gave. But that's why she was like, because I don't see myself, so I'm going to put myself in. Yeah, she said she was a good, and she often did. She said she wanted to be a damn good storyteller, and she was like, I'm going to write those good stories. Thank you. Bye, y'all. Thanks for coming on Zoom.